次特别邀请由 AECOM 工程顾问有限公司的那个郭玉任总监来担任我们这一场的主持。那我们请郭老师，谢谢。
主办单位，Governments， 还有呢，各位热爱步道观台山林的前辈好朋友们，大家午安哈。很开心呢，今天有这样的机会呢，在这个地方呢，跟大家来特别介绍有关于冰岛所做步道的一些公司协力的一些经验。那今天下午的最后一场这个演讲呢，由于刚刚的时间有一点点 delay， 所以我们从3:10开始，还是一直会持续进行到4:30的部分。那这个时间当中呢，大概我会进行3分钟的一个简单的介绍之后呢，交给 Gosman 先生呢，Gomez 先生呢来做这个有关于冰岛的首座步道的一些公司协力的一些经验。那他的演讲大概差不多是60分钟左右，然后会开放大概15到20分钟的时候给大家去做一些相关的问题的讨论。所以待会如果有一些各位想问的问题，可以事先先做一下相对的准备啊。那 Gomez 先生呢，事实上原来是英国人，他居住在英国哈，然后但是到那个冰岛工作已经有15年的时间。那15年的这个工作时间呢，其实前面的10年呢，听说是在为国家公园工作，那后续呢再转到了我们所谓的林业署。那这个15年的这个工作时间当中里头呢，其实呢他一直对于火山的一些地形，还有呢特别是在步道上面做一些有关于冲石沟的一些控制啊，以及台湾呢其实在高山地区经常会出现的一些问题，像台原动员的地区的一些冲石的这些步道的一些管控呢，有蛮深的一些相对的经验。那他现在呢，事实上是在特别领导的这个森林署本身呢，在Sosmar 这样的一个地点啊，实际上就是战神索尔那个地区为名的这样的地区的一个非常出名的一些步道系统的整个自工队的一些工作的这些代理的工作啊。那我简单的给几个这个相关的一些数据来帮大家做一些事先的一些引导啊。那事实上呢，我们刚听到了Sosmar 的这样的一个地区的自工队呢，是开始在2012年。至今大概有3年时间的一个整体性的这些推动。那他们每年的推动呢，事实上时间并不是很长，大概是从每年的5月到9月之间，也就是只有5个月的时间呢，来进行这些步道的维护跟相关的这些整修的这些工作啊。那主要的工作呢，大概有3个类型。第一个工作的类型呢，是步道的这些维护跟整理的这些工作。那第二个部分呢，里头就是刚刚提到的冲蚀改善的这样的一个工作。那最后一个呢，特别有趣的呢，就是他们近年来呢，也特别针对呢这种所谓的 trail mapping 就是在步道的沿线的一些 GPS 的这些定位相关的，不管是资源的这些特色，以及呢这些有关于步道整理过程的一些地图叠图的相关的分析的工作呢，这个做了不少的这些努力。那主要是针对这上面来进三个部分来进行这些工作。那也刚刚的陈真科长呢有给了这样的一个数据，我们可以看得到呢，新竹的自工的维护队呢，在每年里头所贡献的小时数啊，那他们现在的自工的方式呢，大概主要有3个比较大的体系。那第一个体系呢，大概就是6周比较中长期的自工的这些工作的形态。那这6周当中里头就包括了第1周是一个训练周，2、3周呢主要针对某一个这个 project， 第一个 project 去进行相关刚刚提到的3个主要的工作。那在第4周的时候呢，会有个健行周，也就是呢这休息，可以让他们去 hiking 呢，在索尔山区的这些特别漂亮的景致。然后最后的2周呢，再回头来进行第二个 project 的一个整理的工作。那另外有一个这个维修的这样的一个步道的自工的形态呢，是只有2周的，只针对单一这个 project 去进行的。那还有呢，则是进行有关于整体性自工管理的一些工作啊，营运管理的一些工作，包括待会他会特别提到的一些基地营的设置啊，还有一些食物的这些调配、工项 这些相关所需要的工具等等的相关工作的部分。那这个部分呢，这个自工呢，则是工作者是2到8周不等啊、哦。那大部分都是这个回流的自工为主体来担任这样的一个相关工作的这些部分。那我们可以看得到呢，大概每年的部分里头，从去年的数据来看，6周的部分里头有20个自工去进行这些相关的工作，2周的部分有25位。那这一个2到8周的部分里头呢是15位的一个部分，总共加起来到是50-60个人。那在单一的一个夏天里头贡献了250周，也就是说乘以40的话，10000个小时的这样工作的一个整体性的努力啊、哦。那我想这些数据呢，其实非常有帮助大家能够去了解的这样的一个自工队呢，对于整个山区步道维护的一些整体的这些贡献啊，以及呢我们的未来的一些相对的努力的一些目标啊、哦。那时间的关系，我想接下来我们就热烈掌声呢，我们欢迎这个 Charles Goldman Goldman 先生呢来做今天下午的讲座，好，谢谢。
advisement with Postmark Mark on the bottom, South Coast. You can see it's nested there next to the glaciers, Weirdals, Jokut. It's only around 2.5 hours driving time from the capital, Reykjavik. So it's quite accessible in that way. But the last 30 kilometers are unpaved roads, lakes or rivers. So it creates a kind of a restricted access because of the environment. Þórsmörk, the name Þórsmörk comes from the Norse god Thor, and Mörk, all the Icelandic word for forest. But there's always been a forest in the area since settlement around the year 1000. As it is, it's very close to the glaciers, and access is restricted by the geography in the area. It's unique in nature protection sites in Iceland in that it's one of the most popular sites for Icelanders themselves, and less accessed by international visitors. This is our sometimes quite noisy neighbour, the Eyjafjallajökull volcano that erupted last in 2010 and was responsible for cancelling air flights for some weeks back in 2010. Huge ash plume and some weeks of disruption, followed by a layering of ash on the island in different places. And this volcano very much dominates the Þórsmörk area, and our activities and our base camps are more or less in the shadow of it. So we live right next door, and it more or less controls the activity in the area through the conditions that it gives us there. Since 2010, it's been relatively quiet. If anything, the activity has increased the interest in the area and for more tourists. This picture I included here is taken last year, but it shows the remaining lava from one of the eruptions 3 years later, still steaming, still fire, still hot. So itself is a quite interesting tourist destination. So we see different activity on the trails as tourism increases and decreases depending on the sites people are going to see. So volcanic eruption can change the pattern of tourism in the area dramatically. And some of the biggest projects we've had have been preparing trails used for visitors to the volcano. And that only happened since 2010. We also have the Katla volcano. Another one that's imminent and ready to erupt in the next years. For this we have a safety plan because, like many of these volcanoes, they are underneath glaciers, and the biggest primary risk from an eruption is glacier flooding. So we have evacuation plans ready, and this is actually information that we include for the volunteers when they will come and work with us. Everybody working in the area is given this information so they know what to do in case of emergency. So there's a special level of security planning about this kind of challenge, this kind of problem. Glacial rivers crisscross the area, and they themselves are often quite a challenging barrier to getting into the area. This one taken very close to our home in Langidal, the mountain hut. You can see in this picture. This is called the Krossá River, and it's notorious in Iceland because it's particularly tricky to cross with cars. And in the last season, we had to remove 40 different vehicles that were stuck in the river from crossing, including buses with 50, 60, 70 56 seats on them, small cars, some of them completely destroyed after they've been in the river. So the glacier rivers are a real challenge, and they very exciting to drive through, but they're also can be dangerous, and they form a natural barrier to the area which restricts access unless you have suitable vehicles. Here I just marked where the hut is. This is the mountain hut of Langibala. This is for visitors. 70 beds, mountain huts. But to get there, when they arrive by road, they have to cross the river. We have some bridges in the area. We tend to use this style of bridge on wheels because the glacier rivers themselves move. So that makes it very easy to move the bridges. It's impossible to build different bridges on the glacier rivers because of all the changes. So we simply have to keep this one moving so it matches up with the river. And this is the Eyjafjallajökull volcano on the right, of the screen at the top. So this is way above our camp. We are more or less in the valley here, the base camp. It's a valley area, we have a mountain ridge, and the highest peaks we have in Forsberg area are around 800 meters, which is one of them here. This is pictured in June. We can have snow quite late into the season. So our summer months, which are really only from June, July, August, suddenly it becomes just half of June up to half of August, and then maybe just even July. And we have quite a lot of snow. Some of these areas all the way through. To make access to some of the parts of the area quite difficult because the trails remain under snow so long we can't survey them and we can't get to them to actually do any work. Mountain environment and the snow and the ice, they add another level to the safety planning. Taking volunteer groups into these areas requires quite a lot of care and properly trained leaders and proper information about looking at before in the slides from here. They'll be very familiar to look at the work of your groups here. The trail projects involve a lot of rebuilding and surfacing, timber work. Actually, in this case, in this picture, they're building kind of small fences to help stop erosion on the path that's no longer in use, a closed path. So in this case, we'll be using old leftover forest products to create kind of natural barriers to try and encourage the regrowth of the vegetation, stop people from walking on it. Also lots of stonework involved. Stone water bars, we see pictures of those being done here, which is the same way. Stonework is always the most popular with the volunteers. They enjoy very much building these things. I'm sure you know, the trick is that they have to be built big, be strong, and then this type of work can last many years. We're not really using any machinery. Most of the areas we work in, it's very difficult to get machinery. So most of what we do by hand. And here, these guys are demonstrating safe carrying materials. It's very basic, but it's quite effective. And here, they're careful not to damage their balance, straight backs, careful lifting, and moving stones into position so they can build steps. So there's a lot of time and energy spent into training in safe working practice. We're a long way from help in the program. If we needed immediate assistance for an emergency, most likely it would be a helicopter rescue. And although security is in place, should we need it, huge effort goes into timberwork. This was a gully that was completely washed out. You can see a little bit at the top of the picture. There was nothing left, it was just smooth rock. So here they're building timber frame steps. This is the design, a design that we created in Portsmouth. They're pre-made units because this is 1 hour's walk from the mountains to build it. So they carry them in pieces and fix them together and fill them with local material that they take from the site. They're creating these steps kind of pre-built for an installing. Here you can see kind of the limits of our equipment. We're using rather small power drills, so we're building these units down the camp area, and then they're carried up into the site. So preparation is made a nice, easy field, and then everything can be carried into the mountain and put into position. Here, the last finishing off where they're fitting together the platforms. Framing is with timbers that are imported. Imported timber is very common, nice. But the decking here is made from Icelandic growth materials. Again, the National Forestry Service have access to these. So the idea is to build this and then plant grass back into it so that eventually the vegetation can recover it into the wooden steps. So space the left between them. Here you can see better the installation of these steps. It's left with a rough edge, so the straight lines are removed, so it looks a little bit more natural. But before this was done, people were having really, really big problems on this trail, and several accidents have happened with visitors slipping and falling. So we're very quick to try and solve those problems when we can find out about and repair those dangerous sections of the trail. So I wanted to talk a little bit more about this partnership we came up with this year. Portsmouth is at the end of a very famous four-day hike, long distance hike, the most famous and well-used long distance hike in Iceland. It's called the Lögaleiðin. The walk takes you from Central Highlands, and actually Portsmouth is the end of the trail. So there are many companies that sell this trip to tourists, and people come, and they travel on the trail. And gradually it was getting into very poor repair. So one of the companies came up with the idea of gathering in a small fee from all the walkers, and they're using that to create a kind of green fund. And they actually approached us to see if we could then incorporate that somehow. So with that money, we established a new project in last summer with our long range trail team, and they were able then to go off onto this long distance hike and stay in volunteer base camp, wilderness base camp. Around 10 kilometers north of our main camp. And the funding for the equipment, the food, the operation itself came from the sponsorship. We were able to resupply them from our main camp, so every second day or so we'd send a small team up with materials, food, anything the group needed. So it was a kind of a secondary operation 10 kilometers north of our main camp facilities. And we serviced it from our volunteer base camp at Langadala. Again, access issues all the time, quite a lot of rivers across the trail, so you have to wade the rivers to get across these places. So again, they need equipment for that. Ability to change their shoes and the rucksacks dry, the clothing dry in case they fall in. And because it's quite high in the mountains, even in July, you still have large areas of snow to contend with, so it can be quite challenging for access. Another partnership I wanted to mention was the work with the local volunteers. the main part of our program is international. We need a lot of international volunteers, but there are local volunteers active in Iceland. But they tend to be active on weekend projects, short breaks. So we invite them along to our project and we work with them and we host them at the base camp. And that way we have this integration with local volunteer activities. On this occasion we had 40 people together. The age group was somewhere between 66, 40 plus people. These are very special weekends because they're great. It's great to have so many volunteers together. It's a real festival atmosphere. We can achieve a lot of work and it also is a lot of fun for the volunteers. So these kind of gatherings are quite important to us, not to just use the international volunteers in isolation. We're trying to bring them together with local volunteers if we can. So when the Forest Service started dealing with these issues in recent years, they came up with a concept called the Friends of Horsemen, Vignir Horsemen. And the idea of that is a gathering of stakeholders, and that's creating kind of a platform for discussion. And our program is very much a kind of operations on the plan, so that the stakeholders can come together and they can talk about the needs of the area, and then we can actually go out and do something about them with the volunteer program. So in a way we're answerable to this Friends of Horsemen. Inside this organization, association, really they are the companies that are working in the area, that are managing the mountain plants active in the area. So these are businesses that are active there. So they have a huge interest in keeping the area can be because they're all making their money from tourism and they have huge also a good channel for creating funding because it's a unified voice. They have to go to central government or one of the funding bodies to speak about getting funding to the tourism area. It gives a collective voice for the project on the area. And shows just how prepared people are to work together. Even though they may have similar businesses that are actually in competition, they're able to work together very effectively for the good of the area. So there are really three main hut touring companies. And they're similar in many ways. They own mountain huts where tourists can stay. Many people hike, they're a little bit like youth hostels in their way. Basic accommodation in the mountains and varying levels of facilities. But all three of these companies that are active are all incredibly supportive of our work. So they're giving us, giving the volunteers many things. The Forestry Service itself doesn't have any infrastructure in the area, so we don't have any buildings or anything like that. So we rely on these companies to provide the volunteers with showers and in the event of a volunteer being sick, get accommodation for them, and generally just helping us run the program. So it's a very mutually beneficial situation. And although we don't exchange money, we're exchanging a lot of goodwill, a lot of support through other means. One of the examples is that our volunteers can support staff in the huts, help with some of the projects, covering some of the shifts in some areas. We needed some extra volunteer wardens to help. Many of our volunteers are very happy to get involved with that. So another element of companies active in the area that are partner are the travel companies, the bus companies that work there. They run services all summer, bring tourists into the area. But this summer, even though I had 60 volunteers coming and going, I don't think we pay hardly for any bus tickets. I think they're all just given to us pretty much all summer. Companies are also very eager to see work being done in the area. And they provide this as a kind of a thank you to the program. And I think in this case, it would be hard to justify volunteers who are paying a lot of money to the programs if we were then asking for support from the companies around. they know we're not taking money from any volunteers, and then they know that that program needs support, and they're very happy to give it. Again, support in kind rather than support as cash. So this is our valley, this is Langidalen, and Long Valley translates to. And this is the original mountain hut there. This is where we made our home for the volunteers. So we set up a base camp close to this area here. This is the base camp pictured last year. It's a basic camp. You see that combination of using kitchen tents, small hut for shelter, and then developing the services and support we need for the volunteers. So that would include solar power, so we could charge telephones, things like that, and gas heating, so we can heat water, so we can make water for washing clothes, things like that. Otherwise, it's very basic. This small house is really just a place to sit in the evening, get coffee or something. All the volunteers live in tents, so this is the only shelter we have, actually. And we can have up to 20 people in our program, so some nights they can all be together here in place. To achieve this, we had to speak to local planning agencies to put forward a proposal to be allowed to put in a property like this with a temporary structure. And they're quite happy for us to have this because of the work we're doing. It would normally be very difficult to build anything in an area like this. So well protected from development. But for us, in this case, we've been allowed to put this together. The next step might be to move similar setup higher into the mountains. But this one we could easily bring with a truck to be delivered high in the mountains. Then we'll be using helicopter delivery to take materials and equipment up. Here you can see inside the kitchen tent, cleaning time in the kitchen tent. This is the main part of the group. It can be up to 15 or so people together. And they cook and eat together, share all the tasks in the camp through like a rota, so we stay part of the team cooks for the others. Everyone does everything in the group, team leaders as well. So it's a very flat structure that everyone shares all this responsibility. Iceland has some good summer, so if we have good weather, then we can be outside the base camp. Here you can see we have a full group, and we also have the entire staff from the mountain huts, and just put this one in to try and give you that sense of the community that we have there. So we have upwardens, volunteers, foreign staff, everybody living and working together in all these different organisations. And it's quite typical for our volunteers to end the week with a barbecue, Icelandic lamb, maybe one beer. And it's pretty much the flavour of the experience in summer months. The other thing that's very important to our volunteers is a campfire. That's maybe the heart of the base camp. So it's the place for groups to gather on nice evenings. Here you can see the Icelandic volunteers joined for one night, and usually the campfire is one of the most common activities for weekends in our base camp. And that really was a quick run through of the activities and the work we do. I think now we're ready for some questions. So thank you very much for your patient attention.
Thanks, Charles, for your great
感谢 Charles 这些分享哈、啊。那因为刚刚主办单位有特别提醒，因为担心这个要整个的会议延长到六点会比较晚一点，所以我们就把待会儿因为局长也在这边，那有一些主持的部分里头跟一些会议提问的部分，我们会延到待会儿再来做一些相对的这个提问跟讨论的这些部分。那我想在我的部分当中里头，也就这个Goldman 先生呢所做的一些分享，我想来提供一些相对的一些看法啊。那事实上呢，这个冰岛的这个 Forest Service 啊，就是它的森林署啊，跟我们有很多近地相近的一些地方啊。那么事先去查了他一些资料，我也觉得很有趣呢，也在这边做一下简单的一些分享。那它是1907年呢，根据它有一个森林跟土壤的保育法所设立的一个机关。那一直延伸做很多相对的努力，刚刚Charles 也有特别讲哈、哦。那有趣的是，他在2007年跟2013年呢，分别有两次政府的组织改造，然后呢，把它从原来的农业部门转到了环境跟资源部。哦、那我想这个跟我们现在呢在整体国家的组织的一些改变上面呢，有一些异曲同工之妙。那很有趣的一件事情呢，是他们的森林署也特别针对呢在未来的一些工作上面呢，提供了5个重要的工作的领域来提调他们整个森林署的工作啊。那第一个工作呢，其实我看得非常的 impressive， 就是说非常的感动啊，就是说他们说呢他们事实上森林署只掌管呢7000公顷的国有林的土地，那这7000公顷呢，只占它所有森林面积的5%。好、哦，那事实上呢，我们刚刚也看得到呢，冰岛的面积是台湾的3.5分之1左右。好、哦，所以呢，他们的林业呢，就提供了这样一个思维，说，在一个没有树的国土上面的一些林业政策。所以呢，他们对于增进他们本身森林的增加呢，是非常的在意的。所以呢，工作上的第一个重要的使命呢，就是希望从现在开始，一直到2010年，每年增加12%的国有林土地。好，这是他们很既定的目标的一个工作的方向。那除了这样的一个方向之外呢，当然还有其他的一个方向，包括了这个像发展森林的这个产业的有序利用，包括了自己生产木材，做一些湿地的这个本土性的一些运用，减少碳足迹啊，那或者是说呢增加森林的这些水土的保育，增加它的生物多样性啊，改善它的一些环境生态。那也非常前瞻的特别提到了怎么去建立它的碳库，然后呢降低这些气候变迁的影响。那这些都是在5大的重要使命当中其中的一项。那我觉得最这个动容的一项呢，是他们把改善民众对于山林的公共通行，增进民众的健康，也列入了5大工作项目之一。那所以呢，由此我们也很清楚可以看得到，林务局呢在这一波努力之下，对于不管国家步道、对于手作步道、对于这些身心灵的提升的部分里头，所愿意善尽的这些台湾以及国际的这些使命啊。所以我想这个东西呢是提供出来跟大家有一些交流的部分，我们可以看得到国际的趋势以及呢台湾的一些整体性的发展的想法啊。那这是第一点的部分。那第二点的部分里头呢，其实我觉得在这个 Charles 的这些演讲当中里头，我觉得还蛮值得可以借鉴的部分啊，包括了刚刚最后的部分，他特别提到了有很多的这些步道之友的一些合作联盟啊，所以呢，不止呢政府在扮演一定的这种 program 的这些相关的角色之外，也非常努力的跟所谓的一些旅游的协会。那甚至呢，一些当地的这个步道之友来建立一定的这种关系。那我想呢，其实这两年呢，在推动这些相关的工作，在这个计划的同时，其实林务局也有一个国际就是国家步道国际生态旅游的一些推动的 program。那也就是说呢，未来我们可以看得到呢，如果有一些登山客或者一些对环境体验有兴趣的一些个人或者是团体，那到他到山上去爬山。 除了呢，他在山上所花的这些相关的经费，会贡献到当地的山村部落的这些经济之外，也还蛮重要的。可能相对的，借由今天的演讲的借镜，我们也可以让部分的收入呢，去协助这些所谓的步道自动的一些运用。那可能包括了我们刚刚看到的山屋的建立啊，基地与山屋的这些相关的建立啊，或者是说刚刚有提到一些免费的接驳的这些票等等的一些东西。那我想这个东西都是今天呢 Charles 的演讲当中里头提供我们蛮好的一个可以思考的这些方向啊。那当然呢，如何运用在这个山村部落的一个就地的友善繁体，那甚至呢对生态旅游的办理之外，还可以呢去建立可能的保育基金，那甚至让他们有巡护以及呢协助山林的一些步道手作步道的一些整建的工作，也是未来呢两个计划也可以再进一步呢再做一些思维跟努力的一些方向。好，那我想这是我在这个演讲当中你所看到的第二个我觉得很可以借鉴的一些部分。那第三个部分里头我想要提供的呢，大概就是其实我们会特别提到，不管早上 Andy 的演讲，还是下午的 Charles 的这些演讲，其实都提到了，不管他是招募这些外国的志工到这边来做免费的这些相关的工作，那这些这个志工呢，大部分来自世界各国，刚才特别请教他哈，除了刚提到的 local 的团体之外，每年有来自世界各国的60个人啊，来做这些相关的这个工作，那他都是这个不付费的。那更难得的一件事情是我们很多次呢在群里头也在讨论所谓的 crew leader， 也就是有经验的这一个步道的这个领队啊，那长期能不能都 pay 的去做这些事情，那他们的 crew leader 的5到6个人也是没有费用的，也是自愿服务的啊。那所以我们可以看得到他们的一些这个 program 的一些成功。那另外呢，工作假期的部分里头呢，其实我听嘉志老师特别提到，就是其实他非常的生动活泼，他就会让你感受到他是一个很有趣的活动，然后在活动当中里头，你得到很多跟朋友共同工作，建立成就感，然后呢去亲近山林，然后呢去奉献环境的这样的一个整体性思维啊。那所以显然呢，我们从过去的手作步道当中里头的一些责任义务，我们如何能够再进一步的去提升思维，怎么样把一个 program 变得生动有趣，而且能链接，然后变成是大家很愿意来参加的一个这样的活动，也是我们后续可以努力的一些相对目标啊。那我想作为一个主持人，大概在时间的这个部分里头呢的考量，我就提供了这三点的意见来提供大家，抛砖引玉来提供大家来做一些相关的思维。那时间的关系呢，我就把接下来的时间呢交给大会，然后来进行会后的一些这个相关的讨论跟这个意见沟通的部分。那最后呢，我请大家是不是热烈鼓掌，再度感谢大家。